In your, hopefully you receive a copy of today's bulletin. It'll give you an opportunity just to follow along and jot some things down. I do have some information, some truths, if you will, to be able to jot down for later. I think this will be life-changing. I believe this will be life-changing for you. So there, on the other side, on one side, there's all the announcements and some of the things we have going on, so you can stay in tune and be communicated to and grow about what's happening here at Longview First and Same. I always want to use that word. I don't know if it was appropriate. But to and fro is on your bulletin there. Amen. And so there it is. On the other side, that is blank, so give me an opportunity to follow along. Today is also, and I love days like today because we get to have water baptisms, and I'm so excited about that. We've got a few candidates that are ready to go. I'm going to have to hold some of them. I know one in particular, we got to hold her. She's going to want to do a nosedive cannonball double flip with a pipe twist, whatever that is. I only watched Olympics once every 4 years, so I don't know what it is, but she's going to want to do it. And because we're that excited. It's going to be awesome, incredible. I can't wait. I might actually cannonball in there, but I don't want to get bubbled with. So, because it will splash. Aren't you guys excited about water baptism? You understand what that means? Waking you guys up. Listen, we're just having an awesome day planned, and God's already done an incredible, just incredible job so far. Worship team, thank you so much for your leading today. I appreciate everything you have done. What a day we've had so far. But last week, I started a short little three-week series. And I, for lack of other words, I'm going to call it a series because they really don't lead into each other per se. What I did is I just asked the Holy Spirit to give me three specific words, and not just words as far as a word on the page, but a message, a word for our church as to where we are right now. Holy Spirit, what do you want to communicate? What do you want to say to us as a body of believers specifically? What is it that you want to say? What do you want this messenger to communicate? This is not Edgar's message today. It's totally God's. Amen? And so so I say, God, just give me a few words. So that's where we are right now. Last week we talked about healing. And what an incredible day we had. I will say this. I think I have three confirmed healings that came out of last week's service. That's confirmed because people have told me, amen. Yeah, that's awesome. Y'all are clapping like you're used to seeing it every day. Oh, God, just dead versus work, but woke up. It's awesome. Yeah, that was awesome, too. But I'm just saying, we had three confirmed healings already. Church, come on. That's awesome. Awesome. So four confirmed healings out of last week's service. Church, that's incredible. That's the, and we should grow to expect that every time we come in God's house, not just when the preacher starts to preach on healing or teach on healing. That's something we expect when we come into the presence of God, things happen. You say amen. So that was awesome. I mean, I can't wait to hear more. I know there's probably many more out there, but God's still working, and I can't wait to hear about those. So God's still speaking. And we're going to be talking about stuff today that is very awesome. Now today, I want you guys to hear me closely where we're going today. We're going to be talking about prosperity. Now let me hear you say amen. Woo! All right. Here's what we hear about prosperity. I already have four walking out. There he goes again. Okay, now listen. I'm going to go ahead and say I'm sorry now. And I can't apologize for everybody, but I am sorry that this particular topic makes people cringe because of bad teaching that's been around for years. Throw that out there. Now, I'm not saying I'm all that in a bag of chips. I mean, I am something. But thank you for all three of you that got that. I understand. I'm just Edgar, Ayala. But man, there's been some crazy teaching and preaching on prosperity. And that makes people cringe, and I understand that, and I'm sorry for all that. But and one of the things I've asked God to do, this is why we're in this series right now. I ask God to give us, I ask God to give us clarity when it comes to, oh, was about to say, Mark, you need to worship.
Sorry, God.
That's all right, it's all right. I'll cross the jam with you. I don't know what else to do. Let's go right in there. We're going right in there. We're going right in there, folks. I just want to admit that anyone's a distract today. There's an incredible message that the Lord wants to preach and speak to all of us. I'm just going to throw that out there. He does not want today to happen. And it's going to happen if the Holy Spirit wants us to be challenged. So I'm just throwing out the disclaimers out there, but no more apologizing, because I don't need to apologize for what needs to happen. It's going to be incredible. I'll tell you what I mean by it. And what I was talking about a while ago is the Holy Spirit wants to bring clarity of thinking, or in these sections, is thinking, okay? Or what we've had about thinking about healing, thinking when it comes to prosperity. We're asking for God to bring clarity to all that. Can you say amen? That's what we're praying for, and that's what we're believing for, and that's what God's going to do today. Speaking of clarity and thinking, and just things that happen out there, there is a story about the church that gets to this. Sorry, it might not be a bad idea. There's a church out there that said, and the pastor says, you know what, I mean, they're kind of going, how can we challenge our congregation to increase giving? How do we do that? So the pastor came up with a genius idea. He says, for every person that gives $1,000, we're going to give that person or that individual the opportunity to pick 3 hymns. Okay? Still with me on that? We're going to give that person the opportunity. If you give $1,000, then we're going to let you choose 3 hymns. Okay? Stay with us. So that following Sunday, no less, a sweet little lady comes down, slaps that $1,000 in the pastor's hand, and the pastor really didn't. He declared it, but, you know, is it really going to happen? And so, sure enough, this lady comes down and slaps that $1,000 in his hand and says, here you go, here's my $1,000. Pastor goes, well, okay, so he's getting ready for the redemption or the trade-off of what's about to happen. He says, okay, I wonder what 3 hymns she's going to choose. And so he kind of backs off and gets ready and about to have this conversation with the worship pastor obviously. So she turns around and she goes, I'll take him, and I'll take him, and I'll take him. That's great, people. Some of y'all get that lunch, okay? So I can't help that for you. Praise the Lord. All right, now we're laughing. We're a little afraid. The guard's down a little bit. Brother Man is going to bring it today, okay? So I hope you guys are ready for this. But, prosperity. You're going to love this. This is why I said we're going to eliminate the stinking thinking. Prosperity in the Hebrew. You want to know what the word prosperity means in the Hebrew, the definition for that? It means to push forward. Everybody thinks it talks about it. Does it mean it's not like Benjamin Franklin ain't on there? No. In the Hebrew, the word prosperity means to push forward. Can you say push forward?
Push forward.
Put that in perspective. I don't know where I would be today had it not been for the prosperity of the Lord in my life. Yeah. I got to thinking about that all week this week in preparation for today. And even last night, you know, that nice little drive, and I'm thinking, man, I'm just thinking how blessed we are today. You realize we get to pastor a church. I get to stand in front of you today, and I assure you people, let me just let you in on the secrets. People think pastors are just born into this pedigree, and they're just born to just go, oh, that's not how it works. The Lord snatched me out, called me into this, and I'm not the most talented person. I know you're going to be fooled by this. I'm really not the most talented person in the world. I'm just going to be going, I know. But because of his prosperity, he has pushed me forward to pastor. He has pushed me forward to be a husband. He has pushed me forward to be a dad. You still follow me, church? Think about the prosperity of God on your life. It's all about how you think about things. If you think about prosperity in a different negative way, then that's how you're probably going to live your life. But we are choosing today to think about and live out prosperity as God's blessing, as God is pushing us forward to where we need to be. However you want to look at that, that is some powerful stuff. Think about where you are right now today. That because of the prosperity of God, he has prospered you to be here today. I don't know your situation today. God declared, I don't know where you're at. This is so much more than just finances, folks. Please understand. I don't know where you are in life and what has brought you to this place, but I do know that because you are here right now, the Lord has prospered you to hear this message. He is pushing us forward now. Can I get amen? Biblical prosperity. Let's further define this. Biblical prosperity is having the new need so that you can make an eternal difference in someone else. You catch that? Having more than you need so that you can make an eternal difference in someone else. Isn't that what it's all about anyway, church? Can you say amen? So what does that mean for me? What does biblical prosperity mean to me specifically? Here's where you guys can jot a few things down. Let me just talk about the theological stuff on, and then we'll give you some practical take-home stuff. The first one is this. What does that mean for me? The first one is God blesses us to be a blessing. God blesses us to be a blessing. Galatians 3:14 says, he redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. That is so huge right there when you read that, because for one thing, that promise wasn't necessarily given to us as a Gentile nation. Unless you were born into the Jewish descent, the Jewish family, which most of us, I don't think, here are. So we're Gentiles. We came into this because Christ chose to go on the cross, and he redeemed our lives by paying the price of the penalty of sin so that we can all have access to the cross. Come on, church, you with me today? So because of that, all that is working right now in this scripture. So because of that redemption, we as Gentiles can stake claim. Hello? And stake claim to the inheritance that God has for us. So because of all that, and you got to think about the covenant that God made to Abraham. It's all about blessing. That through your name, everyone is going to know you. Because of the blessings, everyone will be blessed by you. Come on, church, with me today. So as Gentiles, we can lay claim to that promise that we can be blessed just like Abraham was blessed. All the descendants from Abraham are blessed. Well, I can grab on to that blessing just as much. Come on, church. Come on, somebody say amen. Amen. When we bless others, this is awesome. When we bless others, God takes care of our needs. When we bless others, God takes care of our needs. Luke 18:28 through 30 says, Peter said to him, and I'll explain to you what him is. We have left all we have to follow you. Speaking of Jesus. Peter said to him, we've left all to follow you. Truly I tell you, Jesus said to them, no one who has left home or wife or brothers or sisters or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom of God will fail. Listen to this. This should just knock your socks off. Will fail to receive many times as much in this age and in the age to come eternal life. Did you catch that? That right now in this age, many times over, we have the opportunity to receive many times over the blessing that God has for you now and in the age to come. Come on, church, that's got to set somebody on fire. That's what living under the blessing is all about. You're saying, what is that all about? What happened prior to that conversation is this rich young ruler who came up to Jesus. And he says, man, what is it going to take for me to follow you? I'm sure he's been kind of following from afar, watching Jesus do some incredible things, which he did. Healings and blessings and delivering. I mean, some awesome things happening. Rich young ruler says, what is it going to take to follow you? I want some of what you've got. What is it going to take? And Jesus says, well, you got to sell it all and follow me. You got to sell it all. Got to give it all and come follow me. Scripture says he went away sad. because he looked at it from the perspective is what he has to lose versus what he has to gain. Ooh, I mean, that's an Edgarism that will come very often, so I need to write that down. That he went away sad because he looked at it from the perspective, well, this is going to cost me something. I'm going to have to lose something. And Jesus said, you missed the point. It's what you have to gain by living under the blessing, by living in prosperity, by being an obedient giver. You're going to be blessed many times over now and in the age to come. You guys still with me today? I don't know about you. I'd much rather have Jesus take care of me than me take care of me. That's what that means. I'm sure not going to ask for a show of hands, but I'll raise both of mine right now. I've done me taking care of me, and I promise you guys, this is not a 1995 guarantee I'm giving your money back. I've tried taking care of me taking care of me, and it never works out that way. Never. I've got bona fide proof in black and white, even red and white on paper, how it never, ever, ever works out that way. When we allow to, and when we live under the blessings and allow Jesus to take care of me, oh, come on, church. Whew. I'd much rather have that equation happening than me take care of me. It never works out, church. I promise you. I guess that's the challenge, is when we get to a point where we don't look at it as what I have to lose. I'm looking at it as what do I have to gain? And again, it's not just about money. So much more than that. So much more. I'll get to more of that personal stuff if I have time, because I'm telling you, on paper, it makes no sense to live what we're living right now. It really doesn't make any ounce of sense. Baffled sometimes at what God does in our lives. Do we deserve it? Is it because Edgar just worked hard for it? No. Just living simply in their obedience and allowing God to many times over show me who he is. And he doesn't have to do that, but he loves to do that. Come on, church, with me. Yes. Whew, I'll get that there. The more God blesses us, the more God expects us to bless others. Get that. The more God blesses us, the more God expects us to bless others. Luke 12:48, the second half of that verse says, when someone has been given much, what is it? Much is required. And when someone has been entrusted with much, well, guess what? Even more is what? Required. I mean, it's just simple math when it comes to God. I have blessed you, Edgar, so I expect you to be a blessing to others. No. I'm not blessing you so that you can be blessed. I'm blessing you so you can turn around and be a blessing to others. Shame on you, Edgar, when you're not. That's what I want to live on. I want to say, you know what, God? I'll take whatever blessing you have for me so that I can turn around and be a blessing to whoever I come in contact with. That's the equation that God wants to live under. Church, are you with me today? I realize it's tough to do, but the more you live that out and you see the miracle and the hand of God in so many ways, it encourages you to keep going out there and doing those things and keep living more and keep living more, because you know there's the many times over when you see that being played out. Whew, how incredible is that? It's awesome. But let me tell you this. We have water at our command. You turn on the faucet, water comes out. Unless somehow you forgot to pay the bill and more times than not. Well, I mean, you saying, God, that's silly. Have you ever been in a third world country where that's not available? Put that on for size. I have. When's the last time you saw someone walking down Luke 281 with a 100-pound clay pot on their head? Because they had to walk about 2 miles to go retrieve water. Water that's not going to kill them, full of bacteria, amoebas, and everything else. When have you seen that? What are you saying? What are you getting at, Edgar? We are so blessed in America. So blessed. I don't think you understand how blessed we truly are. family, and not just individually, if you're a family and your family income is anywhere between $40,000 and $45,000, that's a lot of money, I get it, but you're in the top 1% earners in the world. Did you catch that? If you make anywhere from 40 to 40, I'm talking about a family, not individuals. As a family, if that's what you earn, you're in the top 1% earners in the world. I know where you're going, I see your faces. You're going, woo! I'm like, this is you. Woo! I had to come to church today to find out I'm rich! Woo! Two of you guys get this thing. Man, I'm telling you, brother. I'm here all week, so get your tickets early. I'm still going to preach, so. Listen, I'm not asking for applause. I'm telling you, folks, we are rich. I mean, put that in perspective. Again, I'm trying to help you out. Wrap your mind around that. You say, Edgar, but you don't understand. You haven't been to my house. You're not looking at I know. You're not looking at the paperwork. You're not looking at what I'm looking at. You're telling me I'm rich? Yes, I'm telling you, you're rich. You have no idea how rich you are. Again, it's so much more than money. So much more. Blessing comes in so many forms, shapes, and sizes. Whew. Come on, church, this will preach. It's not even Edgar yet. So, what is the effect of living in the blessing? I know that's what you're asking. So what is the effect of that? What does that look like? In Scripture, I think we'll have this on the screen for you, Psalms 1 through 3. It's three simple verses. And I know you've have read Psalms 1 a million times, but we're going to read this together today. Such an incredible passage of Scripture. In Psalms 1, 1 through 3, and I'm reading it in NIV version, but it says, "Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in a company of mockers. But whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night? That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither." Now, I read all that to get to this part right here. Whatever they do prospers. Did you catch that? Whatever they do prospers. Let's pick on the word whatever, okay? Not the version the kids gave you, whatever. No, I'm not talking that version of it. I'm talking about whatever you do. Whatever means whatever. It's a huge word. It can mean so much for you today. And the psalmist tells us that whatever we do, God pushes forward. Come on. Man, that right. I should have just showed up and just preached that. Because that principle is incredible. If I'm feeling at the grocery store and I see a person in front of me and maybe the Holy Spirit gives me the check, I want you to pay for the groceries. No, don't wait until see what the end bill's going to be. I mean, you just know better. And you decide, you know what, if you tell the cashier, you just let them go, put it on my tab, I'm going to go and pay for the groceries. If you do that, that's part of the whatever. If you do that, what does Scripture say is going to happen? You will prosper. He's going to push you forward. So that means if there's something that you may be going through, maybe a healing, maybe a deliverance, maybe you are going through a financial situation right now where you're saying, I don't know where this is going to come from, but somehow in God's economy, he wants me to pay for somebody else's groceries. That makes no sense, God. Have you not seen my bank account? My check card is wrinkled because it can't do anything. I don't know if they do, but I thought that sounded cool. That makes no sense. Why would I do that, God? Whatever you do, I will push you forward. The blessing is. So God, so if I live under that, everything's going to be alright. So when I do look on the table, I'm sitting down with my wife, I'm thinking through, how is this going to happen? We just live and obey the rest. You think that's pressure? I only created this world in you. I think I can handle your check card. This is God's conversation with communication. That's living in the obedience, folks. Come on, that's living under the blessing. Come on, church, you with me today? Woo, this is good preaching, Edgar. I'm so glad you showed up today. I am too. So I am blessed. Okay, can I say it again? I am blessed. I might have it on the screen for you. I'm not sure. If not, you guys can just follow along. I've got some notes for you to take down. I am blessed, number one, as I put God first. I am blessed as I put God first. Proverbs 3, 9, and 10 says, honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. Did you catch that? Then, God, I'm just going to stop right there. Can I sit down for a minute with that marinade? I said the word then. Did you catch that? I know you're not getting it yet. Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruit of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing. Goodness gracious. Boy, Edgar's getting excited here. Did y'all catch that? I'm trying, folks. And your vats will brim over with new wine. Man. You're saying, so what's the catch? Just put God first in everything you do. That's something. Yeah, this is the part where we'll talk a little bit about money. At least in our family. This is not the easiest thing to do every week, but it is the easiest thing to do every week. I don't know how to explain it to you. But those of you who count my money, those of you jokers who count my money, I do appreciate you. I write on my check, first fruits, every time I write it out, every time, without fail. Why? Because first fruits. I want God to bless the blessing I'm giving back to Him, my first fruits, because I want to live under the blessing. So when my son plays football, and I'm speaking this in faith, my son who plays football, which had a game this past week, didn't break a leg, didn't break his neck, didn't break a rib, didn't have to take him to the hospital. You're saying, what's that big deal about? I don't have insurance, folks, at all. I don't. We won't go into the political side of things. We ain't got insurance. That's a blessing. He's played four seasons now. A few injuries here and there. You can't play football and not expect something, folks. Come on. If not, don't play it. Go play crochet. Whatever the thing with the stick, what is that? Oh, sorry. Sorry. Did I offend all the women folk in here? I didn't mean crochet, okay? Woo! Okay, let's first say. Come on, church. Blessing. Are you still with me today? Blessing. But this is called a conditional promise. Why is it conditional? We got to be obedient, folks. We have to be obedient. You're saying, but didn't God love me unconditionally? Yes, but He does have some conditional promises based on what we're going to do in obedience to Him. Still with me today? There's some things we have to do in our relationship to God to where we have to give the first fruits. We have to. Because if you want to live under that blessing, then you've got to walk in obedience. And I realize it's tough. I get it. People look at it, well, you give because you have. No, it's the reverse. I have because I give. And that doesn't make any sense, folks. I know it doesn't. But in God's eyes, it does. Did y'all catch that? Yeah. I'm 34 minutes on that. Number two, I am blessed as I maintain my integrity. I told you so now. I am blessed as I maintain my integrity. Psalms 84:11 says, for the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does He withhold. Don't you love that? No good thing does he withhold from those who walk, whose walk is blameless. And we talked about this in the book of Romans, but how are we made blameless? Are we made righteous because of ourselves? No. Are we blameless because of ourselves? No. We are made blameless and righteous because what Christ chose to do on the cross for us. Amen. And receiving that into our lives, which many of you guys did, well, that's righteousness. That's how you're blameless. But we have to maintain that relationship by walking in righteousness. Come on, church. You can't just come down to an altar and you give your heart to God, and that's great. And His grace is big. I understand all that. But you can't turn around and go live the same sinner lifestyle you once lived. It doesn't work that way. I know we want to. There's preaching out there that tells you you can do what you want. You're still good. That's called fire insurance, and I don't think that fire insurance is that great. You say, "Woo, you're touching on grace now." No, 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 I'm not. I'm talking on biblical living. I can't go out and go have an affair with my neighbor's wife or go steal the goats if they have any. I'll go do these things that are not righteous living and still expect to live under the blessing. It doesn't work that way. Woo! That's not being preached much. No, you just show up and do your thing. Thing. Whatever thing means. I mean, wants to define what the word thing is. I'm going to define it for you. He's living under the righteousness of the Lord. You've got to live that blameless life. You think, so I got to be perfect? No. Giving you that right there. Because no, I ask you to live now. Not perfect. Just choosing every morning to get up and say, "Lord, I crucify self. I crucify flesh. I crucify Edgar because I don't want Edgar to get in the way of what you have for me today." And so the Holy Spirit gives me the power to make good decisions. Do I slip up? Yeah, from time to time I do. I do. I get it. The Lord picks me right back up. So get back on the road up here. You got things you got to do. I ain't got time for your whining. You ever had God tell you that? Yeah. I ain't know what else to say. He's done that for me. Quit your whining. Get back on the road because I died for you.
Amen.
Man, that's good.
Yes, it is.
All right, I'm moving on. Just do it God's way. Should have just said that. I am blessed as I give intentionally. I am blessed as I give intentionally. 2 Corinthians 9, 10-11 says, "Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply..." Get this, "and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness." I don't know about you guys, I love the word increase and more, and I want it, God. If it's scripture, I'm going to live on that. I want that. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. What does all that mean? That means your giving shouldn't be impulsive. You still with me today? Your giving shouldn't be impulsive. You should have a plan. Let me give you this quote that I learned long ago and I live by. If you fail to plan, you plan to what? Fail. Every time. If you fail to plan, you might as well go ahead and plan to fail, and don't be surprised by it when it happens, because it will. You say, what does all that mean? That means I sit down with my significant, awesome, hot wife, other, okay? And we sit down at the table, and we are intentional with our finances. That hurts. Thank you. I didn't want you to say amen there, though, okay? Now it does. It hurts. It hurts. The reality is, I don't know, Edgar. I don't know, Steph. That's what she said. I don't know how we're going to do this. I said, I don't know what we got to do first. And then we can figure out the rest later. I'm telling you, telling you, folks, Powerhouse to work after you. It works. We're intentional in what we do together. The other intentional part of that is we want to be generous. I'm always doing that. I know it's weird. Maybe you guys don't. I hope you go to the grocery store with me someday, because I'm always like that. I mean, I'm just like, if I get to the grocery store, where am I at? I'm asking, I want the Holy Spirit to tell me, what, do you want me to be generous today? I'm like, yeah. I've done that at Chick-fil-A, I don't know how many times. Ask her. I'm in the drive-thru. If you see me behind you, or one that was in front of me, no, in front of you, that's the Holy Spirit. Especially the Holy Spirit tells me to. Do I have it to do that? I give them a tough old, no. Not English way of saying things. I ain't got it. But God says, do it. And then when Edgar does it, then God says, bam!
Yes.
Hallelujah. Man, I love that. Awesome. I'm almost as good as you. Bam! Blessings. I'm saying, where did that come from? Give generously. You think you just talked about generosity, man. It goes even better than that.
Yes.
I love this scripture. We used to say it all the time. Given, it would be given what? To you. A good measure, pressed down, shaking together, and running over. And on the version I'm reading, it's a little bit different. Will be poured into your lap. Some says bosoms, I never mentioned the bosom. Poured into your lap. For with the measure you use it, get this, it will be measured to you. I'm going to be generous, and I'll spot you one. I'll spot you a dollar. Okay, when you're going to get a dollar back, and you're going to be somewhere where you're going to need three, and the Lord says, well, I'll give you one. I mean, the Lord says, I'll spot you a dollar. But God, I need three. Didn't you just give me one? What does all that mean, Edgar? What kind of blessing do you want to live on? Man, Eddie Good had this. We had this conversation, didn't we? What kind of blessing do you want to live under? The alternative is living under a curse. Yeah. Thank you. No, I'm going to. Because some of us, is even here today, are living under a curse. I said, that's not a judgmental statement. This isn't Pastor being mad at you, folks. If anything, I love you. I love you enough that I want you to prosper. It has nothing to do with me. Nothing to do with me. I want you to live under the prosperity pushing forward of the Lord. But some of us ain't got it. We're living under a curse and wonder why some of the things happen the way they do. Can I be more real? We go at the end of the month, we wonder why we don't. Got a pretty good indication of why that is sometimes. Listen, we've been there convictedly, very shamefully. I'm telling you now in front of you, and I hope this doesn't disappoint you or like knock me down three more notches in your Edgar's or hero book. But let me tell you, we used to live that way. I mean, we gave, but it wasn't first fruits. End of the month, we're going, we ain't got enough. And nothing was coming from anywhere. We learned really quick, God says, but my economy doesn't work that way, brother. It doesn't. Come on, church, you with me today? I really do love you. This is the part where everybody gets all sweaty, your pits all out. I get it. I'm sorry you're sweating. I am. It is what it is. I love you that much, though. I'm ready for us, Longview versus Sunday, to live under the because we're not. It's that simple. We're not. And yes, that concerns this pastor. It does. Because I look out and I see the potential that this church has been prophesied about and the potential of what this church can be. I say, God, I want to live under the blessing because we can change the feels like to say amen. And fifth, and those are your baptismal candidates, would you guys go ahead and make sure the kids are aware so they can come in here, okay? For the rest of you guys, stay still because I'm not done. Number five is, I am blessed as I stay dependent on God. I'm going to say that again because I know we guys are moving around. I am blessed as I stay dependent on God. Here's what Scripture says. Command those who are rich in the present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth. Did you catch that? Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain. I mean, Scripture, that's what I'm saying. This isn't Edgar telling you stuff, guys. I'm reading straight out of Scripture. If we put our hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. I could have just read that one right there. That right there is why we do it. I don't want my hope to be in money. I don't want my hope to be in dollars. I don't want my hope to be in wealth. I want my hope, listen folks, I want my hope to be in God. How does that work like? It works very simple. I walk in obedience to God in everything I do. I walk in obedience to God in everything I do. And God says, I will richly bless you. God will richly provide us with everything for our enjoyment. Did you catch that? Listen, I understand there's a lot of moving around, guys. Listen, we're just getting ready for baptism, and that's awesome. That's church, I love you. I really do. I'll give you a quick testimony. This might sound like bragging on Edgar. I don't want to do it. This sounds like bragging on Edgar's stuff. It's not bragging. I want to tell you of an incredible blessing that happened to us. And you might have seen pictures. I'm going to explain to you how all that works. Earlier this week, and this is where God even cares about the silliest, dumbest things. He really does. All right? The week before that, Stephanie and I were kind of, you know, we love football. And I get it. And NFL's got their issues. And I understand. But Stephanie said, listen, Stephanie said, God, I just want to go to one football game. Knowing very well in our economy, we don't have the money to go pay for tickets at all. And that we feel sorry for us. We just don't. Okay? But that's just a bucket list thing. I want to be able to go to a game. I'm telling you, folks, 3 days later, I got a message in my Facebook Messenger app. This individual says, hey, I have two tickets to the Houston Texans game. Would you like to go? Let me pray. Yes. Pray without season, folks. I didn't have to pray. I already knew. All right? I already knew about that answer. 2 minutes later, got another message. I got two more. I can take Jane. He wasn't going to stay home and eat quesadillas, but he got to go. We just set out tortillas and cheese, folks, and a little grill, and he's fine. Mama, me and Mommy going on a date, bud. Oh, it got better. It got better. We got four tickets to the NFL game. No. It gets even better than that. This is going to knock yourself off, okay? That was crazy awesome. Parking pass. On top of that. Well, who are we going to give this fourth ticket to? Today's my dad's birthday. He is 73 years young. And we call my dad and say, hey, Dad, want to go to the Texans game? My dad goes, son, you ain't got nothing. Who'd you steal? I didn't steal nothing, Dad. I promise you, I didn't steal nothing. I didn't. Someone gave me tickets, Daddy. I promise you. I had a ticket for you. Do you want to go? My dad's not been there. Yeah, son, I'm going to go. So happy birthday, Dad. We'll find you. We get bald head. We'll find you. Okay, we'll find you. Never give up my agenda. We'll find you. Okay, you just go. We'll find you. But it got better. I was on staff with this children's pastor friend of mine in Humble, Texas. He actually works for the Texans now. Well, we caught wind that we were going. He gave us on the field tickets to be on the field before the game. I know. I was like this close to it. I just wanted to slap Richard Sherman, but I just wanted to. We're right there. because we actually selfishly pray, Lord, we just want to go to a game. You want to go to a game? I love you so much, I'm going to lavish something on you. I'm going to give you 4 tickets so your son can't eat quesadillas. He's got to go with you. And not only that, I'm going to make it so where you go on the field and be a kid all over again. Small things, I get it, folks, it's small, but if God takes care of the small things, can you imagine what he does with the bigger stuff? That's what I'm getting at right now. I get it. Football tickets is trivial. I get it. It's not even about the tickets. It's how much God loves me, Stephanie, Jaden, and my 73-year-old dad. So we're walking out of the game together. I got my arm around my dad. He says, son, and I'm sorry if I get emotional on this, but this is awesome. You know what I'm celebrating? I said, happy birthday, Dad. I hope this was the best. And he was just awesome. I mean, he was like a kid, too. 73 years old. He's all trying to get, he's trying to get into the locker room. He's trying to get on the bench. I said, Dad, can't go there. You're going to get shot. I'm like, that's a great prayer. So we're walking out together. I got my arm around him. And he says, son, you know what I'm thankful for? I thought he was going to thank me for the game. I'm 24 years cancer free. And I get to spend this day with my son and my grandson. That's getting better. See, it's not about the football tickets. I got to celebrate a moment with my dad and my son. That's what living under the blessing is all about. It's not about the football game. It's celebrating the fact that God healed my dad of cancer. Put that on for size. 24 years later, he's still here. I think he can actually outrun me, but I don't tell him that. Right? I know. He might fall break the bread, but he can outrun me. That's what living under the blessing is all about. And I thank God for it.